Okay, we would be the next presenter. Would it be okay for you to jump in? You have no choice. Thanks.
So the presentation will be given by Adrien Bourgoin from Observatoire de Paris. The presentation is Paris Observatory Lunar Analysis Center from LLR prediction to test of fundamental physics.
Yes, so thank you very much. Hello, everybody. And thank you to the organizer for letting me the opportunity to present the work we've been doing at Paris Observatory in collaboration with our colleagues from Grasse LLR Station. And today I'm going to present the activities of the Paris Observatory Lunar Analysis Center, so from LLR prediction to test of fundamental physics. So the POLAC service was founded by Jean Chaperon and Michel Chaperon-Touzet. There are pictures of them here, and also by Gérard Francou, which is now, who is now retired. And currently, the members, there are two members, Sébastien Bouclion, the head supervisor, and myself, Adrien Bourgoin. So the service has to collect, distribute, and also process the LLR data, and also provide some prediction and validation tools for lunar laser ranging observers. We have also two numerical tools that I will discuss a bit after, which are basically more or less the same as the one that Liliane presented before, ELPN and CAROL. And now the field of research of the service concerns mainly fundamental physics, but also modeling tropospheric delays. The service is now, since 2019, the official prediction for the ELRS. So the two tools that we provide for observers are the prediction tools. So if you are a LLR station and you want to observe one retroreflector, you can go on this website. You put here the name of the station, the name of the target that you want to observe, the date of observation, and you click on go, and you would obtain the CPF files, or also a more precise file that take into account all the corrections, like the TPF file, at the level of the station. So we have also another one, which is once again for observers, which is for validation, the observation. So if you are an observer, you can put here, in this box, the observation you just did. You inform the format that you are using, here mini format, and you click on go, and you would obtain the residuals compared to a numerical prediction here in this column. You can also plot this residual to see how it's going to fluctuate with respect to the numerical prediction. So the service is also, POLAC is also working closely with an old partner, which is the Grasse LLR Station. So you had some presentation about the different activities of Grasse. So I won't spend too much time on it. So you had some presentation on Thursday by these people. I just mentioned here some key points, the fact that Grasse is firing in infrared data, which allow for a better coverage for the different retroreflectors, and also a better coverage all along the lunar cycle. So also some two important tasks that POLAC has, the Grasse LLR Station has achieved the last years. So here is a kind of summary about the different topics that we are working on with the Grasse LLR Station. So we have, for instance, we work on the prediction for laser ranging to artificial satellite. Also, we try to improve our prediction and validation tools. So by adding, for instance, new LLR station, if there are also new retroreflectors, so hopefully soon. We are also working on a new tool that would be able to schedule observation in a way that is coherent with scientific objectives, like, for instance, for testing fundamental physics to know which reflector it's better to observe. So we have already someone in the team that has implemented such method, especially for observing the orbit of stars around Sagittarius A star. We have also some work on improving the tropospheric delay. So this is something that I have been involved in in the last couple of years, where I was mainly involved in computing the propagation of light in the framework of general relativistic geometrical optics. And now we plan to apply these new tools, these new theoretical tools, to the propagation of light. And we have also a component related to fundamental physics, and especially test of Lorentz symmetry. So here are the tools that we have, the numerical tools that we have. ELPN, which compute the lunar solution, so the orbital motion, but also the rotational motion of the moon in barycentric reference frame. And we have also this one, Carol, which is used for fitting the data. So it takes the prediction of ELPN and then make a computed light time in UTC so that we can make the comparison between the computed light time and the observed one, and we minimize the residuals by changing the parameters of the solution. And this is the kind of residual that we obtain, more or less the same as Lilian showed before. We are now at the level of 1 and 2 centimeters for the most recent observations. So this is residuals in the framework of general relativity, but the nice thing is that when you trust the model that you implement, you can go beyond general relativity and try to test other theories than general relativities. And this is mainly motivated by the fact that general relativity is still a classical theory of field. It's not a quantum theory of gravity. And in an attempt to create a quantum theory of gravity, it was shown that that will lead to violation of some fundamental symmetries of spacetime, and especially the Lorentz symmetry. And to test the possibility of violation of this symmetry, it was created this framework, which is called the SME framework, which stands for Standard Model Extension Framework, which is really general. It provides some parameters in all sectors of physics, from particle physics to fundamental physics and gravity. And it introduces new fields, which are represented here in colored. So the red here, the green, and the Q. So these are new parameters that you have to measure with respect to the result of an experiment. So I'm not going to describe the action of this this framework in the context of test of effect on the lunar motion, so at the level of the gravity and sector matter. I will just discuss the physical implication of this new framework. If you look, for instance, at the term of dimension 4 and 5 here, which are the red and the blue, they are leading to Lorentz violation in the way the spacetime metric is going to generate the matter field, is generated by the matter field theory. And in that case, you would have some violation of the strong equivalence principle. And this is going to polarize a bit the orbit of the moon. Because of some what we call gravity-matter coupling terms here, the matter field actually is not now minimally coupled with the metric, the spacetime metric. And in that case, you would introduce violation in the way the matter field is responding to the spacetime metric. And in that case, you would have violation of the weak equivalence principle, meaning that the objects are not following geodesics of spacetime anymore. So what we did is to include this term inside our framework to feed the data. And in order to measure the value of these coefficients, which are null in general relativity. So here is an example of what we did for the term, the order 5 term, which is here, so the Q coefficients. Usually, if you, what this is called the density Lagrangian, if you expand the density Lagrangian and you go to higher orders, you expect that the higher you are in the order, the shorter is the range of the action of the new field that you introduce. And in that case, it should be that higher order terms are better constrained by laboratory experiment. So, and this one is quite interesting, the 5-1, because actually, if you make the computation to find the equation of motion which are generated by this new term, the Q terms, you would find that for a two-body system, it would generate some terms like velocity over r cubic, meaning that actually laboratory experiments are not the best one to measure these terms. And actually LLR and also the timing of binary pulsars should be the best probes to constrain these coefficients here. So if you want to measure all these parameters. You have actually 16 dependent coefficients to measure, so it's a lot. But you are a bit safe because for the orbital dynamics, you could show that only 15 of them, that we call the 15 canonical coefficients, could be actually measured. So now they are called the K coefficients. So at the end, the equation of motion is not so difficult. It's just you have, you see, this term as a velocity over R cubic, which is appearing. And this term is really important because it's not covered by GR correction, or also PPN correction, or any test that you can do with general relativity, like universality of free fall, also variation of the gravitational constant, or anything else. So what we have done is just to include this in our software to integrate the orbital motion of the moon, and also to compute the effect of this term on the light propagation as well. So at the end, we end up to fitting 83 parameters, so the Newtonian ones, but also the relativistic ones. And what we obtain are estimation for all the 15 canonical coefficients here, which are, as I mentioned, some linear combination of the Q fundamental coefficients. We end up with this value, so we manage to find a way to estimate the unmodeled systematics. Okay, I can go. And actually, so we have the estimation and also the statistical estimates, but also a kind of estimation of the neglected systematics in our modeling. And we can do that with a kind of jackknife resampling method. This is its little name. And this method allows you to work with a subset of data to kind of estimate the possible systematic that you neglected during the data analysis. And with this coefficient, with this value, we managed to improve up to 3 orders of magnitude the bounds that were found by timing of binary pulsar, especially on these two very parameters here. So if you do also a kind of study of the correlation between these parameters themselves, you would find that they are highly correlated. Some of them are highly correlating, meaning that the LLR data is not sensitive to each one of these 15 canonical parameters, but actually to linear combination of these parameters. So you can easily find what are this linear combination, this independent linear combination that LLR is sensitive to. So it's simple, performing a simple SVD decomposition. So what we've done also is to provide not the estimation on the 15 canonical coefficient, but on the 15 independent linear combination of this coefficient. So this is what is reported here. And once again, we reported no Lorentz or CPT symmetry breaking terms. So. That's it. Actually, all this test was also really good, thanks to IR observation that was done by mainly the ground station that we have. So here, just a reminder about the different activities that we have at the POLAC service. So the support for LLR observer, like prediction, validation of the tools, and also our main activities concerning the test of fundamental physics. So if you are interested, you can go to check on this paper where we managed to measure the coefficient for Lorentz violation in the different sectors of physics. That's it for me. Thank you for attention.
Okay, thanks a lot. Very impressive. Any questions? I have one comment. Can we see the slides again? There's still and two slides or three slides back? Yes. I think this is impressive. I don't get it. Bea, can we have an award for the best slide of the workshop? This is really a variation of an estimated coefficient with three parts in a really very cool. Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
We have an online question, actually.
Yes. A question from David Lucchesi. How accurate is your current dynamic model for the moon, especially the relativistic one at the post-Newtonian level, with respect to the current accuracy of laser tracking and with respect to the performance of the next generation of retroreflectors that will be brought to the moon?
So the accuracy of the model is the one I've showed before. in the framework of general relativity, if you compute the prediction of our model with respect to the observation, the residuals are at the level. So here, the last fit that we done is in 2019, because I was working on another topic, so I didn't have time to analyze the last set of data, but we are at the level of the centimeter on the orbit of the moon. So it's the value that we have, and it's more or less coherent with other teams are also doing the level of the centimeter of the accuracy for the orbital motion. So the last time we did a test for the PPN parameter, it was a while ago, but I think we are at the level of 10 to minus 4 for beta and gamma, probably.
Okay.